Welcome to Shepherd's Corner, a program of Always Pulling For You, the podcast where we support Christian leaders with biblical and spiritual resources so that they can better share issues of faith, spirituality, and the teachings of the Bible. I'm your host, Pastor Luis Medrano. On today's episode, we'll continue our conversation exploring one of the most misunderstood yet significant mandates in the Jewish text, the Jewish Sabbath. We're delving deep into the origins of what is known as Shabbat and how this sacred rhythm of God can be enjoyed today. Have you ever been in a Jewish home for a Shabbat dinner? Shabbat is the highlight of the week that brings the entire family together so that the bonds of love and spiritual unity can be fostered. One of the most recognizable and cherished customs related to the Jewish observance is the lighting of the Shabbat candles. This is an ancient tradition that marks the beginning of Shabbat, a holy day of rest and celebration. By lighting the candles, it signifies the separation between the common days of the week and the sacred time of Shabbat. With everyone gathered in the house 15 to 18 minutes before sunset on Friday, the mother of the family leads everyone by praying. Blessed are you, God, ruler of the universe, who sanctified us with the commandment of lighting the Shabbat candles. The Torah prohibits Jews from lighting fire on Shabbat, so lighting the candles right before sunset allows the family to prepare for dinner while obeying the requirements of Sabbath. Just as God pierced the darkness before creation with the words, "Let there be light," the candles give off a light or a clarity to see through the darkness, creating a sacred time of rest and a peaceful time of joyous connection with family and friends. In some families, it's custom to light an extra candle for every child born into the family. Just like the light given by every new candle brings more light and joy to the dinner, these extra candles recognize how every child in the family brings much joy and life to the family. Imagine the impact on the children seeing a candle lit every week on family's table as a reminder that they belong and that their impact on the family is important. That is so powerful, don't you think? Now, the two original candles lit by the mother hold a deep symbolic significance. First, the lighting of the candles represents the presence of holiness, spirituality, and divine blessing during the Shabbat observance. Secondly, they commemorate the two commands found in the Old Covenant books of Exodus and Deuteronomy concerning the day of rest, Shabbat. I'd like to read both of these texts with you so that we can examine the significance of these two commands. Like the Shabbat candles illuminate and bring joy to the room, these two texts will illuminate and give great joy to those that observe them. Please allow me to read them to you. First, let's look at the book of Exodus, chapter 20, verses 8 through 11. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but on the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them. But he rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 through 11. Our next text is Deuteronomy chapter 5, verses 12 through 15. Observe the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. as the Lord your God has commanded you. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but on the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son nor your daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your ox, your donkey, or any of your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns, so that your male and female servants may rest as you do. Remember that you were slaves in Egypt, and that the Lord your God brought you out of there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God has commanded you to observe the Sabbath day. Deuteronomy chapter 5, verses 12 through 15. Saints, what a blessing it is to read God's word. Both of these scriptures that we just read tell us that the Israelites were to keep the Sabbath day holy. Now, the word for holy in Hebrew is kadesh. It comes from the root word kadosh. The word, in its strictest sense, means to be set apart for a specific purpose. One of the errors that has caused so much grief over time is the misunderstanding of this word. Too often, people have assumed it to mean perfection or divine. It's why people struggle when the Bible says that we, as God's people, are to be holy. Now, it doesn't mean we're to be perfect or that somehow we're better than others. It simply means that our lives are set apart for service to God. We voluntarily give ourselves to our Heavenly Father and invite Him to use us however He wishes for His honor and glory. Both of these texts remind us that this day is to be set apart from the rest of the week. If you remember, in Genesis, every day of the week was identified by a simple number, but the seventh day was given a name, Shabbat. This reveals something really interesting. Now, in our culture, it's customary to see people use the weekend to do laundry, clean the house, work on the car, mow the lawn, or even prepare food in preparation for the work week. They see the weekend as a time to prepare for what they need to do during the week. But in Judaism, it's reversed. In Judaism, people are told to work hard for 6 days. Use those 6 days to get everything you need done so that you'll be ready to rest on the Sabbath. The Sabbath day is not a day to work hard and get ready for the work week, but rather the people are given 6 days, plenty of time to do whatever needs to be done so that one can dedicate their time and focus on observing the Sabbath. The whole week points to getting ready and enjoying that seventh day, Shabbat. We don't use the weekend to prepare for the work week. Rather, we should use the work week to prepare for the Sabbath. Now, this may be the part of the podcast that you may want to think about a little more as you think about how you approach and organize your week. Might the Holy Spirit be prompting you in this area? Well, at least it's something to think about, right? Another observation made of these two texts reveals that while in some ways they're similar, we find that they're also different. And that's understandable, seeing as how they were written 40 years apart to two completely different audiences. The text in Exodus was written at the foot of Mount Sinai to the people that God had freed from slavery in Egypt. These were the people who had witnessed His power when He split the Red Sea and conquered Pharaoh's army. The text in Deuteronomy was given 40 years later to the children of that generation that had eventually perished in the desert. It was their children who now stood by the Jordan River ready to enter into the promised land. And Deuteronomy records Moses preparing them to enter in with a reiteration of God's commands. two different audiences, 40 years apart. What immediately catches your attention about these two scriptures is how they begin. The passage in Exodus begins with the word remember, while the passage in Deuteronomy begins with the word observe. Remember and observe. Theologically, these two words are complementary and point to the two main ways God's people could keep the Sabbath holy. Like the two candles on the Shabbat table, these two scriptures reflect the dual purpose of Shabbat in both remembering and observing. The word remember in Hebrew is zakor, and it emphasizes the need to remember or to recall God's acts of creation and redemption. It encourages believers to be mindful of the Sabbath's importance and to approach it with a sense of reverence and gratitude. Personally, I find it easier to understand the command to remember by seeing it as a command of inclusion. And what I mean by inclusion is to focus on things that one should include in their observation of Shabbat. For instance, we should remember or include all members of our family and friends. This is the time that you invite the grandparents and relatives over, or maybe even good neighbors and friends. We observe the day of rest, Shabbat, by including and demonstrating how valuable friends and family are to us by having them over and giving them time and attention. Secondly, we are to include and remember our faith. Right after dinner, it's customary to share a weekly scripture lesson called a parsha. This is a wonderful time to talk as a family about issues of faith and spending some time in prayer. Talk to one another. What is it that you've been hearing? What have you been seeing? How is that impacting your heart? Let's take some time as a family and talk about it. The third thing that might be included or remembered is testimonies. This is a wonderful time for the family to share what God has done or what He's doing presently in their lives. Imagine how a family would be impacted by including or remembering time together as a family, scripture and the study of God's word, and stories of faith. Now, the Hebrew word used in Deuteronomy 5 is shamar. Shamar means to keep or to guard. It conveys the idea of actively preserving or safeguarding the day of rest. It involves a sense of responsibility and diligence in protecting the Sabbath from desecration or neglect. It's actually the same word describing how Adam was to care for the Garden of Eden. Now, the way I found to best understand the command to observe or safeguard the day of rest is by what it excludes. What do I mean by exclusion? I think this is important because if you notice in the Deuteronomy passage, there is a connection between the word observe and the Egyptian captivity. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 15, where it says, "You shall remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God brought you out from there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm." Because this young audience was never in Egypt, and they didn't suffer under the cruel hand of Pharaoh, they may not have appreciated the freedom that they were presently enjoying. In Egypt, they were literally slaves to work and heavy expectations that didn't allow them to worship God. It didn't allow them to rest. The Sabbath to them would be a reminder to never again allow the shackles of slavery to be placed on them. Moses was warning them to never again place themselves in a situation like what they had in Egypt, where they weren't allowed to worship and they weren't allowed to rest. Now, next week, we'll take a closer look at the Jewish experience in Egypt, and we'll see how God wants to free us from slavery and introduce us to the freedom of worshiping Him and the freedom of experiencing rest for our souls. Believe it or not, you really can find this rest, but it begins by excluding all the things that distract and pressure you throughout the week. God, listen to me now. God wants to give you the freedom to turn off your technology, to put away the work assignments, and avoid all the things that are slowly becoming your master throughout the week. Take a moment and think. Is there something that during the week is potentially enslaving you? Is it work? Is it social media? Is it technology? Is it games? Is it the gym? The day of rest is a day to do the opposite of what you've been doing all week. It's giving your mind, your body, and your spirit a chance to rest. But for that to happen, you must guard it from those things that enslave you, no matter how good you think they are or how loudly they demand your attention. You must guard your time jealously so that you don't cheat God. You don't cheat your family or yourself from this precious time of Sabbath rest. Former president's wife, Barbara Bush, once said, "At the end of your life, you will never regret not having passed one more test, not winning one more verdict, or not closing one more deal. You will regret time not spent with a husband, a friend, a child, or a parent." Now, I know that it isn't easy to make time for things like a family dinner, and sometimes it really is awkward to see yourself praying or having deep personal conversations with others. It's so much easier to prioritize good things rather than make time for the best things. There's always going to be deadlines, projects, and people that demand your attention, but what if you were to trust God? What if you were to set aside a day to make some space for God and your family? What if you allowed Him to realign your priorities? Sometimes we don't know what we have until it's gone. Setting aside time to rest, to invest in relationships, and to interact with God is a deliberate choice. I just want to encourage you today to consider how God might want you to intentionally set aside time so that you can experience the blessings and spiritual benefits of resting in Him. Something to think about. Thank you for joining us on Shepherd's Corner, a program of Always Pulling For You. Be sure to subscribe to our podcast for more insightful episodes, and please visit our YouTube channel, Always Pulling For You. Until next time, take care, and remember, I'm always pulling for you.